1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 Hello. Good morning. Are you all here? Are you with it?
Yes.
Amen. That's good. Welcome to our service this morning. For those of you here, those of you who are in your pajamas at home watching it now, that's great to have you with us in your pajamas and your coffee that you're having there. And also to those of you who maybe will be watching during this week, the service. You can watch the service every day if you want to, and you can just carry on for weeks and weeks and weeks watching the service, especially my sermon today. It'll be absolutely brilliant. So you can go back and back and back to listen to the sermon. Anyway, so welcome. It's good to have you with us. And I think we're going to run through the notices now. Is that correct? Okay. So please take note of the notices. Particularly take notice of the beginning of the Lent course, starting this coming Wednesday evening and Thursday morning.
How sweet the sound
that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I...
Okay, and with regard to the Lent course, those of you who have been involved in the past with the 24/7 prayer, this Lent course is from the same, you might say, group as that. So it's based on the book that, is it Greg, what's his name? Peter Greg has written, called God on the Mute, The Problem with Unanswered Prayer. So it's a very relevant subject for many people today, that why does God sometimes seem to be silent? And so that's what the Lent course is all about. So I do recommend that to you either on Wednesday evening or on Thursday morning after the Thursday service. Before we continue, we can ask Lee if you'd like to come forward and share a testimony with us.
Hi, everybody. Okay, now, some of you know me, some of you don't. I just want to say I'm here today to give the biggest thanks to God ever. I didn't have the easiest start to life. And I battled really hard for a really long time. I used to walk past this church daily for 2.5 years. And then the pandemic hit, and I hit the lowest of lows. 7 knives wouldn't cut my wrists. Next day, I was at church. 4 months down the line, God has opened doors for me that I could not even fathom He could do that. And I'm just glad to say to everybody, I know times are tough. But I just want to let you know that God is awesome and He can open amazing doors for you if you just give Him the chance. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for having me. Okay.
So that you don't need to know about unanswered prayer. You had answered prayer.
He opened doors for me. I'm going to Joburg. I'm going to pursue an amazing course in fitness. I'm yet to help anybody who needs help. I just want to let you know that God can help you if you just let Him. He's there. He's always there.
Yes. Amen. Praise God for that. Thank you. Thank you, Lee.
Amazing. Shall we stand? Lord, we thank You that You are in our midst. Thank You that You are a faithful God. That's who You are. Lord, it's not only what You do, but it's who You are. So we thank You that we can sing of Your faithfulness this morning. Tomorrow.
Can't seal it.
So here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Above all else, I adore your name. Above all else, turn my heart to sing thy grace. So many testimonies of your faithfulness. Lord, thank you that it's your faithfulness to us, not always ours to yours. thank you for who you are this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Roger.
This morning's Old Testament lesson is taken from Genesis chapter 9, beginning at verse 8. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth." So God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on the earth." Hear the word of the Lord.
We're now going to go into a time of penitence as we reflect on our life in preparation later on in the service for receiving communion. And being this, as this is the first Sunday in Lent, by custom we read the Ten Commandments. So don't worry, these words will not appear on the screen, but I think you know them well enough. And after the commandments have been read, we'll then have a time of quiet, of penitence. I'll then read a couple of prayers relating to Lent, and we'll then proceed with the gospel reading. So shall we pray as I read the Ten Commandments? You'll remember perhaps that the response after each commandment is, "Lord, have mercy." Hear the commandments which God has given to his people and take them to heart. "I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods but me. Lord, have mercy. You shall not make an idol of anything and worship it. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not make wrong use of the name of the Lord your God. Lord, have mercy. Remember the Lord's day and keep it holy. Lord, have mercy. Honor your father and mother. Lord, have mercy. You shall not commit murder. Lord, have mercy. You shall not commit adultery. Lord, have mercy. You shall not steal. Lord, have mercy. You shall not give false evidence. Amen. Lord, you shall not possess the shall not covet the possessions of others. Lord, have mercy." So let us be silent as we seek that the ministry of the Holy Spirit to convict us of any sin in our life, particularly in the light of these commandments. Thank you, Lord, that your Spirit comes to convict, not to condemn. And so, Lord, we just know from the word that as we do acknowledge our sin, as we do repent of our sin, so you set us free, you forgive us and renew us. So Lord, we just seek that ongoing blessing of your Spirit as we continue our time of Lenten observance. Lord, fill us with your love, fill us with your mercy, fill us with your grace, that at the end of these days, we'll be stronger in our faith and love you more and more day by day. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. I'm now going to read, first of all, the Collect for Lent. Almighty and holy God, your Son, in obedience to the Spirit, fasted 40 days in the desert. Give us grace to discipline ourselves, that we may press on towards Easter with eager faith and love, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And a collect for this day in particular, a collect relating to Noah. God of our salvation, your bow in the clouds proclaims your covenant with every living creature. Grant us your Spirit, renew us in our baptism, and make us faithful stewards of your creation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Shall we stand for the gospel reading?
The gospel reading is taken from Mark, the first chapter, verses 9 to 14. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. As Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the desert, and he was in the desert 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with wild animals, and angels attended him. Jesus' ministry in Galilee. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." Hear the word of the Lord.
Grant that I may speak and you may hear, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The story of Noah and the great flood is often considered to be a children's story, a wonderful story to teach children at Sunday school. It's about an old man who built a huge boat onto which he and his family and representatives of every species on the earth were escorted two by two onto this boat to be saved from a devastating flood. And after a long cruise, the rain subsided, the flood's water receded, and Noah and all on the boat exited the boat to reestablish life on planet Earth, all the time while enjoying a spectacular rainbow before going on their spectacular way, in their separate ways. Is that what we remember about Noah? You know, as I was pondering on this particular sermon for today, I realized, in fact, that in all the years that I have been ordained, and it's now nearly 58 years, as ordained in 1963 in St. Paul's in London, I have never, ever, as far as I remember, and my memory is, I admit, going at the moment, I've never preached on Noah. So I don't know if any of you heard sermons on Noah. Somebody at the last service came to me, "I've never heard of a sermon on Noah before." So we are treading new ground here at the moment. So what is the special significance of this account of Noah and the flood? Because far more than being a children's story, the Old Testament account from Genesis is about God inaugurating a new covenant with Noah. You see, a covenant establishes a new relationship, a new binding and unbroken relationship between two entities, God on the one hand and human beings on another hand. In this case, between Noah, God, and Noah and his family and the, all the creation. And so God in this covenant makes an unconditional promise that never again will he destroy life on planet Earth. But you may ask, why was a covenant like this needed? Why did Noah have to, you know, he had just passed through this devastating flood, and he, together with his wife, three sons and their wives, eight people in all, now had to repopulate the earth because everybody else had gone or been drowned. And so you can imagine how he must have felt in terms of, is he going to be up to this new responsibility that has been brought upon him? And I believe God made this covenant with Noah to assure him that he would succeed and that he would endure. But perhaps we need to go back just a little bit more. Why did God send a flood? Why was this considered to be necessary? Well, in Genesis chapter 6, we are told of the terrible depravity of the men and women on planet Earth. And I quote, "The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had come on earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. And the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. Violence and corruption abounded on planet Earth." Our God, our Creator God, was disappointed and wounded by sin. And the flood is thus a story of God's judgment. You know, and as you read the story, we cannot deny the kind of the severity of God's verdict on the people of this planet. And God said, "I will wipe away from the face of the earth the human race I have created." You know, it's quite a thing just to ponder that fact. Can you imagine the pain and the grief and the sorrow that God felt towards his creation, that he had to embark on such a tremendous, you know, painful experience, you know, of destroying? But at the same time, as God was planning this, he saw that Noah was a righteous man. And Noah is described in Scripture as blameless among the people of his time, and that he walked faithfully with God. And as God looked upon Noah, he had mercy on Noah and expressed grace towards Noah. And then he gave his instructions to Noah to build the ark so that he and his family and all creation could be saved from the flood. And there, Noah, the sons, the wives, and the animals remained for 1 year on that ark until the waters receded and Noah saw first evidence that green life was emerging again. What are the implications of this covenant for us? You know, because it speaks about this covenant was for all creation down the centuries. Well, first of all, we are told, in fact, that Noah was given responsibility to repopulate planet Earth. And when Noah came out of the boat, he was like a second Adam, about to usher in a new beginning on Earth for the human race. Faith in the Lord had saved Noah and his household from destruction, and he and his family were to repopulate the whole Earth. We remember how God had said to Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." And he repeated that same command to Noah twice in order to make sure that Noah got the message. So that was the first responsibility, that life was to be restored. The second implication for us is that mankind was still to exercise dominion over creation. We know from the story of Adam and Eve and the creation there that humanity was given responsibility for the environment. Environmental responsibility is a huge task that was given to people right from the beginning of time. And humanity is still called to be a good steward of creation, of planet Earth, and over all the flora and the fauna of creation. And isn't it sad to think, in fact, that as we ponder the world and the earth, that how there is still this fact that man is not taking responsibility for the environment. I don't want to go into an environmental sermon at this stage, but I think we're all aware of the situation of planet Earth in terms of what is happening. But God sought through the flood that this responsibility was to be reaffirmed for humanity. We also remember in terms of Adam and Eve that when Adam was created, God said to him, I give you every seed-bearing plant for food. But after the flood, God gave a new instruction. And God said, everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you green plants, I now give you everything. Meat could now supplement our human diet. Aren't you glad? We don't have to be vegetarians. You can be, but you don't have to be. God changed his mind for some reason. I don't know. The other thing which the covenant with Noah emphasizes is the sacredness of human life. All life is still made in the image of God, and all life is to be held sacred. Human life is made in the image of God, and all life is sacred. What does that say to you in terms of the world as we see it today? I just want to share with you a few alarming statistics just from South Africa. Now, I'm not going to bombard you with thousands of statistics, but just listen to a few of these. Abortion. In South Africa alone, 200,000 abortions are performed every year, to say nothing about the world. And it was a frightening piece of news yesterday about the UK, that now it is possible, the requirement to do her own abortion through the post. You just got to apply, and through the post will come whatever medication is needed to perform an abortion. That, so simple is it now. So is this command of God being abused? Murders abound. Do we need to say more about that? We just heard figures yesterday how the number of murders have gone up in this country. But the last figures I had from Google, in fact, was that every year South Africa has about 22,000 murders. Violence against women and children have reached pandemic proportions. Well, we're getting here more about that. The figure which I heard here was that there are 1.4 million rapes per year. 1.4 million women are raped per year, or children. And evidently, one in three children is raped every 3 minutes. One in three every 3 minutes. Crimes like burglary and theft are accompanied by violence and murder. And the more I think about it is how God must grieve over our country. And not only over our country, but all over the world still. But he's promised he's not going to destroy us by a flood. I can't say whether the depravity today is less or more than in Noah's day. We will never know. But all we do know is that God is also grieved and pained by what is happening, certainly in our own country and beyond. And so we need to remember as Christians, we need to remember as part of our proclamation that all life is a gift of God and all life is sacred. All life is sacred from conception to death. Fifth point, we could say that God, as we've already highlighted, that God promised never again to destroy the earth by a universal flood, and designated the rainbow as his sign of this covenant. And whenever we see the rainbow, we can be reminded of God's covenant and his faithfulness, and that he will never break that covenant promise that he has made. See, all God's covenants that have come down the centuries have signs to remind people what these covenants are. And so with Abraham, the covenant sign was circumcision. When Moses was given the law on Mount Sinai, the sign, in fact, was the law and the Sabbath. Marriage is a covenant. Can you think what the sign of the covenant marriage is? What is it? Think. Somebody got it right at the 7 o'clock. They're cleverer than you. What do you put on your finger and your fourth? Ring. There's your sign. The new covenant that we have in Jesus also has its sign. Can you think what the sign of the new covenant could be? Pardon? The cross, yes. I never thought of that one in that sense. You are? I think in one sense it's Jesus himself. But it could also be the Eucharist. What did Jesus say? Every time you eat and drink this, you will remember. You will remember what I've done for you. So the signs are an important aspect of God's covenants with humanity. And so the story of Noah and the great flood points to the ultimate salvation that God will one day provide in Messiah Jesus. Humanity, sadly, as we've seen, has continued in its sinful rebellion against God and after the flood. But next time, instead of providing an ark, God would provide his own son. By that act, he would open the door of salvation, not only for one family, but for all who believe in him. The whole of humanity can be incorporated in this new covenant. The only condition is that we believe and we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and what he has done for us upon the cross and the salvation that has been won for us. The new blessings of the new covenant are for those who are in Christ. So John 3 we read, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So we believe and trust in the eternal Son as our Savior, who won salvation for us through his death and resurrection. And Jesus came to establish the new covenant. And our gospel reading this morning highlighted Jesus' baptism, when his messianic calling to be the Savior was affirmed by the Father. Listen to him, the world is told. But we know that after his baptism, he was sent out into the desert. There he was tempted. And what was happening there? The enemy was coming alongside of him to endeavor to deflect him from the way of the cross, from the way of salvation. That was the devil's task. And we know, we are told, in fact, that after Jesus went out of the wilderness, we are told that the devil left him and waited for his time. And when did the devil particularly come back to tempt Jesus? Can you think when it was? Garden of Gethsemane. Father, take this away from me, but not what I want, but on your will be done. The devil never gave up, but he confronted Jesus at the most crucial point of his journey, just before his arrest and crucifixion. And Jesus was faithful. We see faithfulness in him. Our God is a faithful God. And as Jesus came up out of the desert, we are told, in fact, that the time has come, he said, the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. And that is our task. It is our responsibility. That is our message. And if we are not taking that message, nobody else is. We as Christians, the body of Christ, that is our message. It is our message, in fact, if we want to deal with some of the terrible things that we see happening about us. Repent, said Jesus, and believe the good news. And God is faithful. And when we proclaim the good news, when the church proclaims the good news, so things will change. Let me end with words of Paul in Ephesians. Paul wrote, "But because of God's great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our sin. It is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from ourselves, it is the gift of God." And so we praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for the free gift of salvation we have in Messiah Jesus. Amen. Let us pray.
We thank you, Lord Jesus, that in these turbulent, changing times, you are unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever. As we sang earlier, Lord, great is your faithfulness. You've always been there for us, as early as Noah's time, and that you will ever be with us in the future, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, that through your trustworthiness and faithfulness, we are able to depend on you. We thank you for your unconditional love for us, reminded by your words to your Son, "You are my Son whom I love, with you I am well pleased." But we pray, Lord, that you will forgive us for our sins, all those ways in which we have fallen short. We pray for your wisdom and guidance as we go forward. Help us to walk in your ways and to believe and trust the good news and share it with others. We pray for all those in need at this time, Lord, those who are ill with the COVID virus, or those who are recovering, those who are affected by the loss of loved ones. Keep us all from fear at this time, knowing that we can trust you, Lord, and rest on your promises. Romans 8:28 reminds us that you work for the good of those who love you, who have been called according to your purpose, and we thank you for that, Lord. We pray for those who are unemployed or without hope. Draw them near to you, Lord, and show them that you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider, and we thank you that you were faithful in terms of our testimony earlier this morning. We close with prayers for the peace of the world. God our Father, you are the source of all truth and peace. Look with mercy on your children. Purify our hearts from all hatred, falsehood, and prejudice. So guide us by your loving wisdom that peace and righteousness may be established among all people. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
So we stand for the peace. So may the peace of the Lord be with you always. We have the offertory song. You're the Lord of all creation. All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own have we given you. Bless these gifts and use them in us in your service, for Jesus Christ's sake. We go into the Eucharist. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. It is right to give you thanks and praise. It is right to praise us, Father, for all your goodness and your love. When we turned away, you did not reject us. You came to meet us in your Son, and welcomed us as your children, and prepared a table where we might sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms upon the cross, and with love stronger than death he made for all a perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night before he died, he came to the table with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, we bless you. You are the bread of life. And at the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, we bless you. You are the true vine. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Father, send your Holy Spirit on us now, and may this bread and wine be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these gifts, make us, who know our need of grace, one in Jesus, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this act of praise and lift our voice to sing the song of heaven, forever praising you and saying, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." And so, as the Lord has commanded and taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so we do now prepare to draw near and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And would encourage those of you who are at home also to prepare to receive in faith the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Is pouring freely and your perfect love. from the grave, you rose in power. Now forever you will reign, the highest king and humble servant. Come and take your
So give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious. Almighty and eternal God, we thank you for feeding us in these holy mysteries with the body and blood of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, and for keeping us by your grace in the body of your Son, the company of all faithful people. Help us to persevere as living members of that holy fellowship and to grow in love and obedience according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Together we say, Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord, send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and all those whom you love, wherever they may be, this day and forevermore. Amen. So go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect need. The great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and prays for me. My name is graven on his hands. Is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair, tell me of the will within, upward I'll look and see and live, you made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. My God, the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. So hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the
coming.
Bless you, thank you.